Okay, we're preparing a barrel to be made into a drum. So go ahead and take a look at this barrel. It's already been put together. The staves have been glued together and the inside of the barrel has been dippled. That's this type of patterning that's been made on the inside. And that patterning is to break up the sound. The kind of the barrel shaped body is one way that that the sound is kind of broken up. There's more complex geometry that the sound waves can move around in. If you just have a cylinder, you get a bit of this air column pushing back and forth, and I think it sounds a bit like a little basketball-y, sometimes we call it, or like bow, wow, wow, wow. You get that little bit of a kind of interference. So just a barrel shape alone kind of helps break that up, so that kind of first sound, boom, is the more kind of, you know, dominant sound that you hear, and you kill some of that extra sound. And then like barrel makers or kind of traditionally, these bodies are carved out of a single piece of wood in Japan, and you know, taiko makers would carve, you know, intricate patterns onto the inside that additionally go to help break up those the sounds even more. So I'm not exactly, I mean, there's people who do kind of research on this, or, you know, a lot of folk knowledge too, just from people who made a lot of barrels. A lot of people say it's useful, but I hear that it's your barrel already has to be kind of round for that to make a difference. If it's not, then you're gonna, you know, maybe it's not the biggest kind of thing that's affecting the sound quality. But so some of the other drums we have are maybe like, if you want to come in real quick, I'll kind of just try to demonstrate just kind of in theory. One way that I've seen this done in our club and a lot of the drums I've reheaded is we take a piece of plywood and we kind of score it so that's kind of flexible, and we kind of attach it on one end here, and then it goes across to like one that's maybe two down or something. And then, you know, and then you continue, you know, top of this one to the one, two over, and top of this one to two over. So you get this kind of rifling almost, it looks like, on the inside, like this kind of spiral kind of pattern. And that's what I've heard from older members more recently. I didn't know this. I've been reheading the drums for a while. And then Gary Wong told me that that's also to break up the sound. I thought it was to hold the barrel together or provide stability. I also used to think biscuit joints were to provide stability, but I've learned since then from drum makers that it's really just to get that alignment, to get that barrel to be super circular, and then the wood glue is what's keeping it together, that the biscuit joiner is really not, you know, not necessarily for stability. I mean, I guess at some level you're talking about the, you know, if you're dropping this off of a truck or something, like it's, you know, it's gonna mess up the geometry, whether it's biscuit joint or wood glued, right? So, you know, I don't think these things are gonna just fall apart like once they're like wood glued together. And you see some of the earliest taiko like made in North America, kind of have the barrel rings like still on the outside of the barrel. That's something that I think kind of as drum makers, you know, really trying to, you know, make their barrels, you know, look like taiko, or, you know, really look kind of like, you know, professional instruments, and also just not have that kind of that hoop on the outside. They're, you know, different kind of designs that they came up with, such as putting kind of a ring of, you know, nicely, or the right diameter cut wood on like the inside of the rim. That's one thing you see. And then, you know, the various kind of joinery techniques between staves, and then that type of kind of interior like rifling, you know, just that spiraling, I mean, I should say, that I've seen before. Okay, so that's that. This drum, as it was donated to us, has very flat top, right? And so the problem here is that the hide will, as you strike it, boom, 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 it will vibrate and stop against the kind of large surface area of this rim, making that buzzing sound, right, that you're trying to kind of cut out. So the way we kind of get around that is we give it a kind of a pretty steeply sloping, I'm not sure how steep it needs to be, but it's you know, it's sloped on the interior surface here. And then just making sure that the outside is just lightly beveled too, so it's not like sharp, right? And so to do that, you can take a power sander or something. If you got it, that would be great. This is nothing on here right now, but then, you know, just kind of run down this edge as you can, and then you can, then I think you probably get some, you can keep doing it with a power sander, here, I'll just, like, what I've been doing is this. You know, once I've kind of got it into the shape I want, I just do this for a while, turn it around, and, you know, try to get the same motion. Maybe start singing a song or something, or a song. Maybe just keep going this for a bit. Until it's nice and, so I'll do that, and then I'll kind of make sure that this is not sharp, and then I'll do the other side. I might just give the full barrel just kind of a smoothing, a sanding before we varnish it too. This is really nice already. It may have been sanded actually. There's a bit of kind of a, I don't know, faces to it though, you know. So I might just lightly, let me, I'll give me. Exactly. I'm just trying to go all around a couple times, just trying to rub out that those faces, make it less round. I think it's probably done with a power sander. That's why. Similarly, I'll just try to. Smooth that out, round that out. So I think anything else for the preparation? I think that's it for from this stage. When you're making it from the, if you just had a barrel, that's not what we're doing here, but we've done that before. And then part of that process is, taking it apart and then cutting off the ends, right? If you see a barrel, it's much more, thinner at the top and bottom, right? We just want that middle section, so we'll cut off the same amount from the top and the bottom, and then put it back together. And then sometimes we'll remove staves. You can kind of get a smaller diameter that way. Then you kind of, before you take apart your barrel, number the staves, right? So that when they fall apart, then you can put them back in the same order, because they're generally already fit by the hooper, I guess, to fit well together. And then what we've been doing is we use the rings from the barrel, and we just lather the inside, the joints with glue, and then stick them back into those rings, and those rings hold them in shape from the outside. Then when we take off those rings, it's still circular. But yeah, the biscuit joining or the dowels also help you, align them as well. Okay, that's this phase of the process. All right, so now we're going to varnish and finish the wood before we do anything more with the drum. We're using what we had in the stock, which is this finish that is a stain and a sealer. Just look for if you have a stain that's just by itself, you'll probably want to then seal it or wax it or something. And if it's just the finish, then if you want that just supernatural color wood, then you can go for that. Kind of a two-in-one is kind of what we use a lot. Here's another barrel that is already kind of finished. The difference here just between one that's sanded and ready to be finished and one that has a fruit on it. So let's just apply some varnish now. And you can see, this is pretty light. And this has been sitting in our shed for a long time. So part of that could be that it was not super mixed when I first poured it. But this is kind of nice, huh? It's kind of get that nice golden color. You can kind of really see the difference. So we'll go ahead and varnish the whole outside of the barrel and the rims. And then I think we'll probably not do the inside, but we could. Just to get that nice seal on it. Okay, yeah, so we'll just do this. And I'll probably do the rim. I don't know if there's any secret to varnish. I tend to maybe over apply. It's kind of one of my weaknesses. Since third grade, I got kind of in trouble. Yelled at by my art teacher for dripping the paint on the color wheel project. And I've always had it in my head since then that I've used too much paint. Did it fix my problem? No, I don't know why. I just I can't not paint without just beating it everywhere. So, okay, so we'll just do this and then let it dry for a couple of days. Okay, so I did varnish the inside. A lot of the barrels I've worked with have had like wine residue in them. So I've kind of not, but in this case where it hasn't been used for wine, I guess I don't see a reason not to varnish the inside. According to the helpful packaging, it hardens in the wood, not on the wood. So I think, you know, just because there is places for it to absorb on the inside, I guess I'm gonna just varnish the inside. But yeah, here's that. And then I'm also getting the rim, just get everything varnished. This is a dry hide. You can see it's like really stiff. If I wanted to unroll it, it's actually very difficult. It won't unroll. But I've just soaked this hide for about maybe just 4 hours or something, maybe 6 hours, and it's already super pliable. And so I'll let it soak for at least a day, and then maybe start cutting it then. Okay, here's a template for cutting the hides. And what I'm gonna do here is I'm making something that I can just plop down on top of the hide, the white hide, and then I'll trace out the circle that I need to cut out, and then also where I should cut the lines for the mimi. If you look at this drum over here, there's 1, 2, 3, 4 cuts that hold the dowel this way, so that when we pull down on it, it pulls down on the hide. It's nice having two of it. It spreads out that force over a greater area. We did one where there's just one, and it just really pinches it down, and we call it the octopus drum, because at each place where there is a dowel, it just gets pretty pinched. So like having two relatively thick, I guess mimi are good. If you come in real close here, I'll just show you really quick. This is a bit confusing because it was also drawing for an eight mimi version. I'm actually going to do a 12 one, so these faint ones out here are actually not being used for this one. The kind of Nazca line-esque ones are the ones I'm making now, and so I've divided this into like 12 segments. So each of these, so there's two that cross at 90 degrees and then 30 degree, you know, they're all 30 degree arcs. I've drawn them all up to the last one so I can show what I'm doing here. We zoom in here. I've measured on each of the lines that are in our template. I've measured, I think, is that 5 centimeters off from the edge. And then I've put a dot there. And now I'm taking a measuring thing. It's a compass, but and then I'm going to align 3.5. This is what I've been doing for a couple of years now. And I'm going to make a line that's 7 centimeters. I mean, you can obviously be different length based off your dowel or your design, but I've been doing 7 with marks on the 0, the 2.5, the 4.5, and the 7. Meaning I'll get a 2.5 centimeter mimi, and then a little gap between them that I guess is, what did I say? Is that 1 centimeter? No, 2 centimeter. And then 2.5 for the actual ear. Yeah, and so what I'll do now is I'll bring that over here. Well, I guess I could just start by using the hide, but I'll go ahead and make the cuts in here, and this might mirror the process for what we'll do with the hide. Okay, so I'm gonna cut my guiding holes for the, what do we call this, the template. And so I'll just use this to, once it's on the hide, we'll just mark or even just score directly through this template. But what I'm gonna do to this template is what I do the hide to, is whenever I've lined my marks, I'm gonna put my chisel right on this line that I've just made. And for this one, I'm just bisecting it right in half. And then I'll just hit into a wood something underneath so that it catches the chisel well. And then one like little trick that I like to do is I keep so this chisel will have a flat side and then the 8 slope side. I keep the flat side pointing to the middle. So as I hit that midline, I'm gonna flip it the other way.
I mean, they just need to be lines, really, so. I don't know if that's super important. What I kind of noticed, though, is, like, I want the Mimi to, if not all rotate the same way, like, if they're all cut with the same kind of curvature and then you put tension on them, I don't want the Mimi to turn together, so I'd rather have them, like, resist each other. So I just alternate on the other sides. I guess you could also go this way, this way, this way, this way. I don't know. I don't even know if that's like really a useful thing or not. That's just, maybe it's just superstition, but, or just kind of not actually addressing the thing I think it's addressing, but I do that just to try to get it a little more even, I guess. So I'll do that for each of these. Just scoring our template. Yeah. Okay. So we're gonna trace the outline of the the template using a charcoal pencil. Now it will the wet hide will like just suck away the ink of like Sharpies and like other pens and stuff. Sometimes you can get these I'm not sure what they're called, but they're kind of like waxy feeling, and like they do mark a lot better on wet hide. This charcoal pencil is doing great. And we'll trace the outline of the template, and that's where we'll cut. And then we could either just maybe trace through these, but what I'm gonna actually do is just pound through the hide through the template and kind of hope that it doesn't disintegrate the cardboard too much in that time. I've actually, I think templates are like the way to do it and kind of more industry standard. Most times I haven't used a template. I actually make the circle using kind of a diameter, a string and a diameter, and I trace it out. I do all the math and measurements usually on the hide, or I have in the past. And it's kind of because I've reheaded lots of different size drums, and I'll make the, you know, measurement and then just do the hide. But you know, I think it wouldn't have taken that much time to make a template. Probably would, then I would have all these templates for all our different drums. Oh, I broke it. So I don't know. I do think the record, the industry standard is make a template, but sometimes I've just found it easier to just work directly on the medium. So this is one of the few times I'm using a template. And partially we're going to try to get a bunch of hides ready for these new barrels that we have over there. And so we got to get them on, we got to prepare the molds, so that's what we'll do. So yeah, while this is still on here, I'm going to drive this through both the template. Scores through the hide, and if I need to work those slightly bigger too, I can do that after this step. Just using a chisel on the hammer. Somehow. I think that's on my foot. Anyway, should we ask the audience? Mm-hmm. So I got these green scissors.
Yellow.
What do you think at home? Green or yellow? But anyway, that's not important. What's important is that we're We're gonna cut out the height now, just following this template. And so you could make the round, like you could make it a circle before you drive in the Mimi holders holes, kind of whatever your workflow is, but I just did them all in one. Certain places of the height will be thicker than others. And it's kind of interesting just how easy it cuts. Whenever we can, we try to, you know, use, or we always try to use it as efficiently as possible. I don't know if this will, I mean, there's not a use that I have for that at this time, but it's too small for even like a small shimmy. I think, I don't know if some people have used them for like a craft or something. We did make some patches out of one time for kind of a different prod, or beheading a kind of a PVC barrel and patching the heads on that. So yeah, I'm sure there's creative uses for these, but yeah, I'm not sure, just a bit small. Alright, so here's the rest of our, even though it's all dirty now, but we'll dip it back in the water.
Did you show that process?
Oh, yeah.
Are you
still early?
Yeah.
I guess we could just show. Here's our next one in here. Just let's see the pipeline. So here's another one that we have. Oh, I should have unrolled it a bit. We're going to be able to get at least like one more round out of this. And then, yeah. So we'll do that one next. You can see that like they do have previous cuts out of them, so sometimes we buy it just in, I think they're a half hollowed or something. It's like you can see the back and it kind of wraps around or something. Yeah. Anyway, so the next step we got to do is put the okay, so the next thing we're gonna do is put the dowels through the Mimi like this. And so the first thing you need to determine is what's your hitting surface. And let's see, I don't know if you can tell right now, but this side is like, it's kind of bumpier. I guess that's where like the fat is. And then this side's more smooth. So the smooth side is the outside. Can you kind of zoom in and can you see a bit of a difference?
When there's a light shining on it, it's a bit easier to see.
Okay.
Yeah, which one is this?
This is the inside. Are you filming?
This is the inside, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so on the inside, you can see it's like a real bumpy. And that's going to be on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
Not our hitting surface. Our hitting surface will be the outside, the exterior of the hide. So that would be on the outside of the animal. And it's just, you can see it's a lot smoother. Yeah, if you can look at this cross section real quick too, how it's like all mottled and bumpy. The inside looks kind of like the cross section, and then the outside is like shiny. Okay. All right, so we're gonna put in, starting on the outside, right? We're gonna put the Mimi in through, or the dowel through this hole, then out this hole, in this hole, out that hole. So just kind of, because it needs to extend on the outside, remember to start on the heating surface, the outside of the drum, and then you're gonna put the dowel through these slits, and this part can be a bit tricky. You can, if it's too tight of a fit, just like cut it slightly bigger, get your chisel, and cut a little bit more. I might have to do that. Otherwise, you have to kind of really kind of ply the hide around it. Oh my god, like that. One time I told somebody, don't push the dowel through the hole, move the hole around the dowel, and they thought that was helpful or maybe just comical, but I think it's easier to maybe keep the dowel in place and then push the hide around it. It wasn't supposed to be like a silly, I don't know, truism or something. It's just like, I think it's easier to move the hole around the down. Given that this is a slightly smaller head size, 12 Mimi is going to be a bit tight, but I think we can get it to work, and if not, I might interlace with a slightly shorter set or something. For this first pull, we're not even taking it to a high tension. This first pull that we're gonna do today is just gonna shape and mold the hide so that we can later do the differential soak and then the main pull. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and do that for all of these and then we'll catch back up then. All right, so we have the hides all finished up. I'll show you that real quick. So we have the dowels and the Mimi. I alternated kind of a thicker one with a slightly thinner one for each one just so I'd have a little bit of maneuverability when it's on there. They are kind of tight. This is a little bit smaller diameter head than the drums I normally had. This is a newly prepared barrel here. And so you'll notice something about the rig setup is that it's a little bit shorter. We don't have the whole raised platform on the jacks because we're not going to be using the jacks at this phase. We are going to be molding the head, but we don't want to put too much of a stretch on it because it's actually going to come back off. That head will come back off. And we'll let it like dry super well. I think you probably could just do it all in one if you're willing to just like, you know, let it sit out for a long time and continually kind of, you know, you keep the, or I guess you could just let it all dry. I'm improvising. I guess you could just like let a bone dry on the drum and then re-wet at the top and then get it down. But what I really want to kind of prevent is when we get any pull going on that these need to be super dry because the wet hide will rip. So this is the biggest thing kind of facilitating if you can get a big pull or not is if you have, you know, dry Mimi, but it's not gonna pull if the head's not wet. So that's why we have to do that differential soak. So once it's already been molded, we'll be able to, you know, it's all dry. It's just this, you know, dry hide that looks like a head. We'll pour water into the kind of bowl, right? Let the heating surface or that, I guess the head part of it get wet while keeping the sides dry. And that'll let us finish it. So I'm, you know, taking it off lets it just dry quickly and evenly on the inside without keeping it up on the barrel or under a tension or anything, and you know, risk molding or anything like that. So so that's why the first pull is not like a permanent pull. That's also why during the first pull we can leave our incense actually inside the barrel while it's under tension. And this is kind of a tradition. It's definitely in our club, but you know, kind of I think with wider use, a lot of drum makers in the United States comes out of the Buddhist churches of America. So I think Mark Miyoshi and some, you know, and other just kind of temple dads or, you know, moms or, you know, who are making drums for the kids at temples and stuff. Or in the instance of Mark Miyoshi, who goes to study taiko making in Japan and then kind of apply it to barrel taiko making in the United States. And Mark Miyoshi has like a long history too of solidarity work with indigenous peoples in the United States. So I think Mark Miyoshi attributes some of his kind of spirituality not through kind of a intention, you know, like wanting or like, you know, wanting to be like native or act native, but just through kind of the relationships he's kind of built over years and stuff too. And I think he says it kind of just rubs off on him. And I think that comes from a lifetime of like experience and like activism too. So I don't think that should be kind of taken lightly or like us to, you know, to misappropriate or misuse kind of, or misattribute kind of like indigenous mythologies or spirituality either. So I think, but recognizing that whole circle and that whole history, I think it tells an even kind of more powerful story about Taiko's presence in the United States as being something about community building and like solidarity building. Anyway, I'm gonna light some incense now. And I'm gonna put this inside the drum.
It's a cherry blossom scented incense, which is perfect for our cherry blossom festival, where this drum will be take part in. We will be, I think we'll be halfway through this drum at that point, and I think we'll do a we'll do an exhibit for people at the festival so they can see and learn a little bit about drum making, as well as maybe try their hand at pounding, loosening up the hide. We'll have it, my intention is to have it ready by then so that we could have it under tension at the festival and let people experience this for themselves. All right, so I'm gonna, the other thing we kind of recognize is the life that goes into making this drum, from the tree that makes the barrel and the animal that provides the hide, as well as the tacks that come from the earth, and then all the, you know, the time and energy that people put into making a drum and making a taiko ensemble happen. So we kind of recognize that. I'm gonna just say, Mama Renos, Mama Renos. All right, I'm gonna put the head on top of it now. So I'll put the head on the barrel and I'll get the rope out. Oops, make sure it's cool. I just rinsed it. And I will get the rope and I'll start doing our stringing up thing. So give me a second, we'll catch back up. All right, so yeah, we're stringing it up now. So going from, this is a slip knot, self-tightening, and then wrapped around a couple times. So it's kind of simple. Up, around, back down under one of the cross beams, back up to the mimi, and so on and so on. We're just gonna do this for all of them. It helps if you have another person kind of holding down the other side so that you're not kind of pulling it at the start too. And then when we get to, can you come on this side real quick, sorry. When we get to this side here, we just actually just lift the whole thing and we kind of put it under there. You wouldn't have to do that if you had another stack of 4x4s, or if you just kind of raised the whole thing on like another platform like this or something. So maybe that's in the future, if you're trying to make it easier, I would do that. But this doesn't, we're gonna be tightening the ropes, but it's not gonna be an extreme tension pull like the second heading will be. Okay, so I think that's good.
Okay.
All right, so now I'm pulling the tension through the rope. You can see I've strung it a little up. And now I'm just trying to pull the slack through. And you can use like a, in this case, a screw or like a screwdriver as a lever if you need to. And I'm just pulling all the slack through. I'll do that one more time and then we'll move on to our next. So, yeah. Okay, so now it's strung up. Just real quick, each of these are, they're kind of tight, not super tight. We tried to pull that slack through. I would run that slacker a couple times on the second stretch. On the first one, as long as they're decently hot and kind of the same, I think that's probably good. And then it's just secured with a couple knots at the end. And then a lot of that is just wrapping up the leftover rope. So we're gonna find the two lengths of rope that are between two mimis. So here's one and here's one. So instead of twisting the ones that belong to the same mimi, we're gonna twist the ones that belong to two different mimi. We're gonna slip a bocce in here, and let's just start by doing two half twists. And for consistency, they're all gonna need to have the same kind of directionality. So from the top, we'll do a clockwise turn to make them twist. So like that. I'll be working this here. I guess that's okay. Yeah, I'm gonna do this for each of them. And then try to get the mashi in the middle of this segment of cord. So, something around, see, I'm twisting it about middle distance
That'll make twisting easier. And so real quick, let's just zoom in on one of them. I'll show you real quick. So I'm gonna be doing a right hand twist. So I'm gonna go under the one on the right, over the one on the left, and then twist clockwise. I guess it would still work if you, now you get weird, sorry. right handed goes behind the one on the right, over the one on the left. All right, so that when I start twisting it, if everyone did it the opposite way, like counterclockwise, left handed, that would work, but they need to be the same. Or at least, yeah, for them to all line up nice like they are now. They need to be the same orientation. So. Cool, so these are all in. And this is how we'll tighten them. This will be the only way we kind of tighten it in the first pull, the molding pull. So I'm gonna go ahead and give them each another twist. If you're working with multiple people, you can spread yourselves out to opposite sides of the drum and do them in sequence so that you're tightening on opposite sides. And then once it starts getting a bit tighter, I might want to do a pattern. So I'm going to go every 3, 1, 2, 3. Just yourself, you can pattern it out so that you're not, wait, if I do it by 3, I get to the same one. You should do it by something that's not divisible. But I'll just move over one. Base up the geometry. Some of these are a little looser than others, so I'll just get them a little tighter. Try to even out the tension. So we can even pull. But I'm going to be a little careful about pulling it too much. If I stretch this out too much, and then when I take off that head after the mold, it'll probably warp. And I really don't need it under a lot of tension. At this phase, I want to get the Mimi nice and squared. So I'm going to kind of agitate these a bit with a hammer. Oh, the dowels make this a bit tricky, but I'm going to try to make sure these are all even. And the other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to tuck the hide. And this is going to need to happen before it's too tight, or you're not going to be able to pull the hide off itself. But we're going to do the best we can to tuck that hide up under itself. And you can use sometimes like a thin piece of wood, just something making sure that you're not gonna scratch the barrel to kind of push it up. I might need to do a little bit of tension. But yeah, I'm gonna go around and make sure it's all tucked in as best as I can. All right, we're kind of shaping the Mimi now. And one kind of trick we can use is to use some sort of kind of shim or wedge, and I'm gonna be using paper. I'm just gonna shove that up under there, and the paper's gonna help, just the friction of it's gonna stop that hide from sliding back down. We could use like a bigger thing, like this cardboard, to kind of push up under there and lock in that Mimi. But even just like a light paper, it absorbs the water pretty fast and expands. And so we can just push it in there and it just sticks. So this helps us get that nice Mimi shape that we want. And then underneath the ropes also help pinch the hide down. So yeah, so then we'll be able to shape our Mimi. Here's a quick example of the Mimi molding method that we have. Paper and cardboard underneath that's holding it in place, holding it tucked in so that it will dry like this, and that the edge of the skin, which is pretty sharp, will be tucked in, and it will have this nice cloudy, doughy like look to it. All right, Lisa's stepping on the drum. At this phase, we're not under a lot of tension, and we're gonna do a lot of this in the second phase, but I'm not even sure if we should do it at this phase, but what I'm kind of imagining is it just, we're kind of agitating it, letting that tension kind of, you know, the head to move and settle into a nice kind of even place, as well as kind of give a first pass at breaking up that hide or the, you know, the collagen that has just, you know, it's just been soaking and cut, and just at least start giving a little agitation. I think it makes the pull a little smoother. It's kind of from past experience. However, just like different hides have different thickness too, so that's another thing. This is slightly on the thinner side, but not incredibly thin. So I think this will dry, and you know, it'll pull pretty easy, I think, just having felt it. But we're gonna just give it a little bit of a break in now, and just kind of let all those Mimi kind of get settled. Yeah, it was like this, for instance. And we'll just have to kind of live with that, I think. Kind of fold. But these Mimi will move a lot, the drum. They will move a lot on that second pull. They'll probably drop down. Probably a good deal. If at the first pull, if they're kind of still way up at the rim, like that you couldn't reasonably fit tacks, you're probably fine. They will get to that point. So honestly, these Mimi are gonna be kind of low in the end, kind of maybe more like how this one's so far down here. So yeah, you might wanna just cut a little bit on the closer side, but you still need to be able to get it, you know, over the rim and this part of the process. Okay, so looking back, I didn't get footage of the next part, but once this first pull is done, you're actually gonna remove the heads. And they're gonna look kind of like these dead heads here. They're gonna retain their shape. They're gonna be kind of hard skin. Sometimes we use these as set pieces or as decoration. But once you're ready for the second pull, you're gonna take the prepared head and you're gonna soak it on the top and the bottom here that's being done with the wet towels. You can also just kind of fill it up with water on the inside. It will kind of hold it like a pan. And that's gonna let the hitting surface get nice and wet so that it will stretch, but keep the sides bone dry so that those Mimi will not rip under high tension. The differential soak and the whole second pull is on a video that I uploaded on reheading a drum, and it's the same process from this point, so I won't repeat it here, mainly because I ran out of time. This was a project for the Davis Cherry Blossom Festival. At the festival, we had an interactive exhibit where audience members could learn about drum making traditions in North America, and they could actually participate and help us pound the hide for that second stretch. There was also a small poster exhibit that explored the history and the innovation of wine barrel drums in Asian America. I wish I had more footage from the festival here, but by the end of the weekend, we had a drum that looked and sounded like this. There's a little more footage I have, but it does not include tacking.
All right, so we're just about done here. You can see how much this head's moved. This is the one we made over the Cherry Blossom Festival. One thing that, if you got time, you might want to just check that it's making a similar pitch around the rim. So this is pretty good. It's mainly when it's not super circular, but if there's too much maybe tension on one side, you can kind of play around with the pitches and try to get them closer by adding just a little bit more tension. And I think that's mainly acting against like the two axes of an oval. But at this point, the reasons why I think this is a good time to tack is it's really taut. I can't push it. You know, when I'm stepping on it, it's super hard. We're starting to get little micro kind of tears on the surface, which is probably just, you know, indication we can't get too much more stretch out of it. And then the real thing that's really making me stop here is we've got a Mimi that's starting to grow all night. This was pounded for 2 days with occasional stretching during our festival. We let participants help pound and break in the head. It, you know, just because of all that was going on, it was a little less regular than I would have liked. So I'm actually not sure how much we did. But this is pretty good, and this is a lot of pull here. In one of those pictures, I had a post right at the festival. I think it was Victor Fukuhara had a like a hide pulled down super far, and like an NATC kind of compass. It looks like this. You know, you could, you know, just stylistically, at different points in history too, that either cutting off the mimi or leaving them on. Today's standard is to leave them on. You know, so in this case, you know, maybe that's not the prettiest aesthetic right here. But we got a good pull out of this. I think we could have just evened it out a bit. If you look on this side, you know, this is actually just, you know, barely big enough really. So we weren't super even about how we pulled it. It's partially because, you know, maybe this wasn't the flattest ground. And we just maybe hadn't been applying it maybe carefully or methodically. But that's overall pretty happy about how this one's gonna sound. I might just add a little bit. Just a last adjustment. This one doesn't have much pull on it at all, actually. But I want to be careful because I am actually adding some tension to our weak. And these are under a lot of tension, so when those mini break, it's not pretty. That will look fine now.
Okay, I didn't get footage of tacking that drum. Unfortunately, I haven't got footage of tacking since like 2017. This is the reheading of drum D that we're looking at. This isn't the most ideal for a couple reasons, particularly the spacing of the buhl. They should be a little more spaced out. And I think kind of making that plan and making those marks ahead of time, you could figure that out. I'll try to make some video on that sometime, but you know, go ahead and mark ahead of time, particularly if it's your first time, like where you want those tacks to be. And then you can either use a drill like I'm doing here to make guide holes, which you can then, you know, put the tack in like we're just seeing right now and then hammer it in straight. Or, you know, even without the drill guide hole, you can just use your fingers and the hammer to kind of just line it up, hold it in place with two fingers. That's at least how I do it. And then hammered in. And I found over the years that I actually just prefer doing it without the guide hole. We've lost a lot of drill bits, and sometimes, you know, you get off even with the drill. I just trust the, you know, being able to hammer it in straight at this point. But you know, it takes time to get good at it, and part of the reason some of our drums are so wonky is because it's often people's first time, and we're often involving a lot of people in making the drums. So sometimes they're not the most beautiful, and I do think it's nice to aim for good looking drums, but they do also represent, you know, a team that is working together and keeping this tradition alive. And I think that's beautiful in its own right. So I'm happy too when I see our wacky tack drums. So here's the final product. It's a bit of a smaller drum than our main series. Actually made some smaller stands to go with it. And here's the backside. It actually cracked during the last bit of stretching. So this is it being kind of sealed back together with epoxy while the heads were still on. When I take the heads off, I'll also kind of make sure the rims are looking good. It's a smaller barrel than I'm used to working with, and a little bit of a lighter wood. I think it was just under a little bit too much tension. So, you know, learn lessons as you go. And yep, that is this new drum made at the Davis Cherry Blossom Festival.